الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I received multiple, I would say almost 12 brothers and sisters all over the world asking me to tackle the subject of Sufism. And inshallah, after a long wait, I decided that I would do that. From an academic point of view, and a disclaimer at the very beginning of the series, because this will not be a one, you know, presentation or one live broadcast. I may have to do multiple, and that is why you're noticing Sufism in the scale, Sufism on the scale, part one, which is really introduction today. But a disclaimer that I'm not inciting any hate, any resentment against anyone who practices or you know, defends or promotes this trending of Islam. I'm just trying to explain to Muslims what Sufism is. And I will make sure that my presentation is fair and just in the sense of providing evidence, and that is why we said on the scale, meaning on the scale of the Quran and Sunnah, on the scale of the Quran and Sunnah based on the understanding of the three generations Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praised according to them. But today, let me just introduce the subject by saying, when we speak about Sufism in general, we could categorize them into three categories. Sufism pertaining to detaching yourself from the world, belittling this life, not being interested in this world. The concept of zuhd, and zuhd is that you give up, and that is actually where the how the term Sufism initially emerged, and it was not blameworthy, it was praiseworthy. And if this is the concept, you know, giving up the world, this is a good concept. We're talking about Abu Huraira. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu used to live in the masjid, and he used to tie a belt around his waist to overcome hunger in order to spend the time in seeking knowledge. If we want to talk about the zuhd from that perspective, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to sleep on the ground. And we know that at one time he was asked, Caesar and the emperor of Persia, they sleep on beds made out of silk, and you're sleeping on a mat, ya Rasulullah. This is Umar ibn al-Khattab, al-Hasan al-Basri, al-Junaid, and Sufyan al-Thawri, Ibrahim al-Harbi, الأئمة، الإمام الشافعي، الإمام مالك، الإمام أبي حنيفة، الإمام أحمد. So that particular approach of Sufism, and that's how actually the term Sufism emerged, because they used to wear wool, and the word wool in Arabic means Suf, Sufism. That's how the term emerged. Of course, some of the people, they say, no, Sufism is a reflection of the purity of the nafs. There is no evidence for that. As a matter of fact, the correct view regarding the term Sufism, that it is not an Arabic word. It's actually a Persian word, Indian Persian word. It has nothing to do with Arabic. But this is the first category of Sufism. Individuals who sacrificed this world for the hereafter. But let's be careful here, because what is meant by it here, a structured or a disciplined detachment from this world, the proper concept of zuhd, which is what the world or the money or the wealth is in your hand, not in your heart. That's what Imam Ahmad defined zuhd is. This is what zuhd is, that the world is in your hand, not in your heart. The money is in your hand, not in your heart. Meaning if it increases, you're not happy, you're not joyful. If it decreases, if it goes away, you're not sad. When Imam Ahmad asked, what is the proper meaning of zuhd? He said that you have 1,000 dinar, golden coins in your hand, not in your heart. You're not dying for money here. You see, you're seeking the means, you're working, because we don't want to promote that principle of leaving the world to the non-Muslims. What is happening with the, if we leave the world and the money and the wealth to non-Muslims? No, Islam teaches the ummah to create that, to strike that balanced approach to the spiritual side and to the material side. If you leave wealth to the non-Muslims, they will use it to stop Islam from progressing, from advancing, from spreading. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ لِيَصُدُّوا عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Indeed, those who disbelieve, they use the most beloved thing to them, which is wealth, in order to hinder people from following the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, if Sufism, if this is the concept, regardless of what the term is, listen, if you say that you're a Sufi in a way and you follow the Quran and the Sunnah and you're detaching your world, yourself from this world, and you understand the Quran, and you say no matter what, is that, and that is where that term is okay. Al-Junaid, one of the scholars, like we said, Ibrahim al-Harbi, al-Hasan al-Basri, if you look at the Sahaba, all of them, they detach themselves from this world. And this is something that we should do. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كما ورد في سنن ابن ماجه, if I'm not mistaken. He asked him, Ya Rasulullah, direct me to an act which if I do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love me. And if I do also, the people will love me too. The Prophet said to him, detach yourself from this world, Allah will love you, and give up wanting what in the hands of people, the people will love you. So this is a good concept, but provided that you don't neglect completely the world. Let's go to the second category here, which is the dangerous one, and that is where the bid'ah is. Those who introduced, you see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed enough curriculum, do and do not do, to purify the nafs, to be a moderate and just person, balanced person. Now, the second category, they introduced their own curriculum, the dancing, the drumming, the hitting of the blades, you know, the mawlid, the religious innovations. And that's the part, those people, they came up with innovations. Their intention is to do what? Is to purify their nafs, is to Sufi themselves. We say no to that. We say no to that. And this is, by the way, the majority of them. The majority of them. And that is where the concept of murid and murshid and bay'ah. Murid, someone who is following of a certain sheikh, and he is the murshid, he is the guide, and he gives him a pledge, whatever he does, no. Islam, no. Your pledge, your allegiance to Allah and His Messenger, and you are not to introduce anything into the religion. The dancing, hay, hay, Allah, hay, Allah, hay, and all that stuff. No, brothers and sisters in Islam. Even sometimes, those individuals, they have a very good intention. Let's be fair. They are sincere. But sincerity has to be paired with knowledge. Sincerity has to be paired with knowledge. During the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, كما في حديث أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه والحديث أخرجه الإمام مسلم, three individuals came to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asking about the manner of his worship. Listen, one of them said, I will pray tahajjud every single night. The other one said, I will fast every single day. The third one, no wife, no children. They want to become closer to Allah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not like that. He got on the pulpit and he said, I have heard what those three individuals have said, and this is not my way. I pray tahajjud at night and I sleep at night. I marry women. I have family. I fast and I breakfast. We are ikhwa, be careful with this, because كل بدعة ضلالة. Imagine كل, وهذه صيغة جمع, a strong form of جمع, every بدعة, every innovation, regardless of what it is a misguidance. وكل ضلالة في النار, and this sooner or later will lead you to hell, whether permanently or whether temporarily, Allah knows best, based on your tawheed, whether it's still impact or not. That's not my subject here. But I will share with you a very famous author, خرجه الإمام الدارمي, عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه, was living in Al-Kufa, and أبي موسى الأشعري. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari entered into a masjid in Kufa. And Abu Musa al-Ash'ari saw something in the masjid. He said, it looks good to me. You know, and that's the feeling that you get when you see these Sufi practices, the innovative Sufi practices, the Allah, Allah, and dancing, you know, and mawlid and all that stuff. I mean, it looks good to me, but something in my heart, I feel funny about it. It doesn't feel right. There's something about it that doesn't click. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, radiallahu anhu, knowing that there is more knowledgeable person in town than him, he immediately said, you know what? I'm not going to do anything about it. Yes, it looks good. But, you know, I feel funny about it. There's something that is not right. So let me go to Abu Abdurrahman, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. So he went and he waited for Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu until he came out. Abi Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu immediately addressed Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and he said to him, Ya Aba Abdurrahman, I saw this and ma ra'aytu illa khayra. I only saw something good. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu asked Abi Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, what did you see? He said, I saw people sitting in the masjid in circles. And in the middle of the circle, there is a head, there is a sheikh. And in front of him, there are pebbles. And the sheikh, in front of them, pebbles. And the sheikh will say to the circle, سَبِّحُوا مَاءَ, meaning say Subhanallah 100 times. And the circle would say what? Subhanallah, 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 Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah. That's how every... So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud talatham, he placed a mask on his face because he was known. And he entered that masjid. And he stood on the top of one of the circles. Look what Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said. مَا أَسْرَعَ هَلَكَتُكُمْ يَا أُمَّةَ مُحَمَّدٍ. How hasty you are, nation of Muhammad, followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How hasty you are to being ruined, destroyed. هَا هُوَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Here he is, the messenger of Allah. مَلَابِسُهُ لَمْ تَبْلَى. His clothes still there. Meaning the time between his death and now is not there. The things that he left behind us. وَآنِيَتُهُ لَمْ تُكْسَرْ. And the utensil where he used to eat and drink are not broken yet. And you are doing this? Is that how the Prophet taught us how to make tasbih? How to make how to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And look at this, look at this. لَأَنْتُ. Whether you are عَلَى مِلَّ أَهْدَى مِنْ مِلَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Whether you are on a millah, on a way which is better than the way of Rasulullah, that's why you're doing this. Or مُفْتَتِحُ بَابَ ضَلَالَةِ. You're opening a gate of misguidance for this ummah. Imagine this. This is the reaction of one of the companions to a practice like this, that a lot of people would say, is the misbaha. You know, the misbaha. We know the ruling of a misbaha, as long as you don't believe that it's, you know, you could use it, you know, if as long as you don't believe in it, that you could do tasbih without it, and the tasbih is accepted without it, you know. But just that, here's what I'm looking for in this hadith. Here's what I'm looking for in this hadith. One of the narrators of this hadith, he said, by Allah, I saw the majority of those people fighting in the battle of Nahrawan with al-Khawarij against Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. Allahu Akbar. You see, when you open a gate to bid'ah, it's not going to stop there. It's not going to stop there. You need to understand this. Maybe the person who initiated it, he had a good intention, but it's going to keep building to something else. Something else. Imagine those people, they ended up fighting Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anh, with the campaign of Al-Khawarij in a battle called Al-Nahrawan, fighting the cousin of Rasulullah, the student of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anh, someone who was brought up by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, taught by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Why? Because kulla bid'atin dalala. Even if you look at it like it's a good thing, it's a good intention. I don't want to prolong this. I want to finish here. But the third category, which is really the most dangerous of them all, the people who believe in incarnation, Ibn Arabi, Al-Hallaj, Al-Tilmisani, Ibn Sab'in, Ibn Al-Farid. And inshallah, I will talk a little bit more about those. But those are the early, a very early group. And they are close to heresy, to disbelief than to Islam. And this is unfortunately the most devious of Sufism. And normally in my speeches, I always use the term extreme Sufis, and I refer to group two and group one. But the moderate ones, who follow the Quran and Sunnah to purify their nafs, those are okay. Again, brothers and sisters in Islam, this is an introduction to the series. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, I will, inshallah, if Allah wills, bring about every belief, every ritual they have, and present it in the scale or on the scale of Quran and Sunnah. And let the Quran and Sunnah, because listen, whether you agree or not, there are people who are for and there are people who are against. I understand that there are people who are not going to like this. And they're going to probably resent me for saying this. May Allah guide us all, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And I want to tell you, I love you all for the sake of Allah, regardless of how you feel towards me. But if there is people who are for and people who are against, who should be the judge? فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. When you dispute over a matter, then you should take this matter to the Quran and Sunnah. And that's what I'm going to do. A practice that is promoted by Sufism, group 2 and group 3. We said group 1, we're okay with it. We have nothing to do with that. They are with us. We are with them. They are with us. There is nothing wrong with that. But group 2 and group 3, category 2 and category 3, that is where we're going to bring about their beliefs, their rituals, and present it to the Quran and Sunnah, and let the Quran and Sunnah be the judge. Jazakum Allahu khaira. And if I said something which upsets any of you, I love you all for the sake of Allah. And whatever I said right is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whatever I said wrong is from myself and shaitan. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.